choice.
Nope.
We have to do this show.
Yeah, now we're live. So welcome to the show that we have to do. It's brought to you by Starburst and Bourbon, so.
It's brought to you by Green Powerade from Nickelodeon.
See, I was just talking about the Ecto Cooler that they're supposed to be bringing back. But I think it's sugar-free, so what's the point?
Yeah. Because no, like, responsible adult is going to fucking drink that shit.
No.
Anyway, so you shove all the sugar in it.
Kids, that's the problem with kids today, is they need more sugar. Like, where there's big push to take sugar out of stuff. I think we give them more.
Well, that's the problem, isn't it? Everybody, we replaced, like, sugars with, like, syrup and shit. It's like, well, sugar. In my day, we just had sugar. Sugar, right. We were hyper. And we didn't listen to our teachers. And look at us now. We're working dead-end jobs.
Yeah, losers. But see, that's the problem is we think too short-term. It's like, yes, and a lot of sugar right away. It makes people obese and diabetic and lots of problems. But we need to build up.
Sugar doesn't make you be a diabetic.
That's
right. Like, sugar is not trying to fuck with you. Like, you abuse sugar. But, you treat sugar like it's like there to serve you.
But it's all short term anyway. If we keep pumping it into people, eventually Americans will develop like a tolerance to sugar and will become super powered like American. Like,
look,
die off, but it's Darwinism.
Look, I took a marine biology course, so I know all about evolution.
Right.
And if evolution's taught me anything, it's that if we poison enough of us with sugar, we will eventually evolve to be immune to it.
Right. No, like I said, some of us will die off. That'll be the weak. I'll probably be one of them. But in the long run, it's for the betterment of humanity. So.
Well, according to Overwatch, I have a 55% shot of making the cut.
That's 5% over the under. Yeah. So, yeah.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah. I like those odds.
Yeah, I'm into esports now, Steve.
I know. You're an esport.
I am an esport. That's how I'm going to refer to everything about me from now on.
What is the going term for? Because I get the esports thing. We've talked about it. I don't mind the term, like, because in my mind, just because you call it esports, I'm not trying to say like somebody that plays Dota is on the same level as somebody that plays in the NFL, like. That's always the argument is, oh, they're not. It's not a sport. And it's like, well, neither is bowling or darts, but
bowling's totally a sport. It's a bunch of. In fact, it's almost more impressive if you see some of the people who bowl.
Right.
Like they have to consistently throw a heavy fucking ball straight.
While fighting the odds of a heart attack, because most of those bowlers are like me.
I just don't like the term esports. Like, I think
it doesn't bother me.
It's not really the, like, so much they use the word sports, even though I don't think, I don't know. I guess it's fine. Just saying, like, the prefix e in front of sports sounds so lame.
Yeah,
I was gonna
say that's the more offensive part. It's not the sports and esports. It's that whole, like, putting a letter in front of a word. I mean, that anybody that does that's terrible. So thanks for joining us here at Njoystic.
I just don't understand like why it couldn't be like just, you know, develop a league like the video game championship.
Well, they have it. I mean, the MLG, Major League Gaming.
Major League Gaming, there you go. So you're a professional gamer. Like, that's fine. Like, it's still cringy as fuck, but it's fine. It adequately describes, like, you tell me you're like an esports athlete. The only reason I know what that is because we do this shit. Like, I wouldn't know what the hell you were talking about.
Well, maybe it means you compete in any sport that starts with the letter E. And, like, I can't really think of any. They got the equestrian stuff in the Olympics, which I think's ridiculous, but...
Yeah, what is, All right, you entertain our audience. I need to find some sports that start with the letter
E. That sounds like a good Google search.
It's one of the top ones. It's pretty awesome.
It's a good thing to start our show out with too. It's like, well, esports is a video gaming thing, but
this is kind of bullshit. They use shit that is like like for pool, like they call eight ball a sport,
but
that's pool,
and that would be billiards, which is a B.
Yeah, and then they have English billiards.
No, that's just billiards. It's a variant of billiards. Some,
well, that's what it says right after. Sometimes just called billiards.
Well, then it's just billiards. What do you mean sometimes just called billiards? Like, I think most 99% of the time it's called billiards.
And, question esports is on here. So
yeah.
The Eden Fives. But it's a handball like a sport derived.
Rugby. Yeah.
Derived from the English sport fives.
Oh, well.
The fuck is fives? Oh, that sounds cool. It's like racquetball, but you, like, have a glove around your hand, so your hand's the racket.
Oh, yeah, that does sound pretty cool. Like, it sounds
like a sport you would wear big glasses.
Well, have you ever played racquetball?
Maybe in like PE a long time ago.
So we used to play all the time. We had a Y membership, and our Y has racquetball courts, which are cool because racquetball, like if you ever have an asylum that closes down, don't turn it into some scary ass video game setting. Like you're set for racquetball because that's just like a small room with solid walls and a viewing gallery up top for some reason. Like,
yeah.
I don't know that anybody ever watched us play racquetball, but they could. There was a.
They could if they wanted to, right?
And whereas getting out with racquetball and Y5 sounds like it would be perfect is because there's a way to play racquetball and then there's a way most of us play racquetball. And the way most of us play racquetball is like, oh yeah, you can win by scoring this way or that, or you can just try to hit your friend in the face with the ball as hard as you can, like either bouncing it off the wall so fast that they don't have time to react, or what's even better is when they're in front of you. And they hit it off the wall and it goes back behind them. Because then you could just peg them with it and be like, oops, like, I didn't mean to do that. But their back's to you. They have no idea. Like, you could have just had a second ball in your hand waiting to cue it up. And fives would make that even easier because it's a lot easier to aim if you're using your hand. Just, like, grab it and whip it at them and be like, oh, sorry. Like, I didn't mean to do that.
Oh, I'm seeing one here. Enduro. Now, tell me if this sounds familiar. A motorcycle sport with main objective to traverse a series of checkpoints, arriving exactly at a predetermined time. The courses are usually run over thick wooded terrain, sometimes with large obstacles.
I'd call that a race.
I'd call that trials.
Yeah, well, yeah. Well, I'm confused. They say designed so that you arrive at a predetermined time. Like, if you beat the time, do you lose? Is it like, oh shit, I got to slow down because I got to hit this
you're
time?
You're racing against the clock. It's trials. Everything I read from there, see trials.
So it should be called Trials Endurolution.
Not anymore. It shouldn't, because you said it, and everyone realized it was a bad idea.
Puns and titles is always the best idea.
But me and my brother actually just got a gym membership yesterday, and it's...
Like a workout gym or just some guy named Jim? With selling memberships.
Yeah,
like.
we're in the professional gym club.
Cool.
The Praise Gym. But we our thing is we want a place to play basketball.
Sure.
For the most part. And, you know, hopefully we'll have some discipline to use the other stuff. But, I'm kind of uncomfortable with it because I just know, like, how this shit turns out. Like, and I know I have no stick-to-itiveness for anything. So, as you can see from my time on Njoystic,
it's like the one thing in life that you've latched onto is probably the worst possible thing.
Yeah, but this was a weird part of it. Like we went through, we paid, like we got like a cheaper deal because me and him signed up together under like a package thing, and but luckily it's his card on file, so I could just fucking skip down and he'd be fucked. But so we get signed up and then we're like, well, we're here. Let's, you know, go shoot around and maybe check shit out. And to get a basketball from them, like they have basketballs, but to get one, you have to give them something on you of like value. And people give them like your keys and shit.
Yeah.
And my brother was about to give him his wallet. And I was like, don't give them you're not giving them your wallet. And I'm like, here's my fucking Zune.
Yeah, right.
It's like, Because if I lose that, I'll be annoyed. If, like, me or someone I know loses their wallet, I'll be fucking pissed.
But the problem is you can't care. You can't act like that's why you're doing it. Like, oh, give him this. I don't care about this. Because that defeats the purpose.
Those were my words. Those were exactly my words to the woman. It's like, if you somehow lose this, I can live. Like, if we lose our wallet, we're stuck here because we take the bus. And so, like, we go, we shoot. And then I come back to the counter and the woman's just taking, like, she won't, like, deal with me first. She's like, she's on the phone. She hangs up the phone, then takes another call instead of, like, my 2 second, like, here's your basketball. Give me my fucking Zune. I still have that Zune. I still use it every day.
For those of you that were born, like, after 2000, a Zune is basically an iPod, but, like, with none of the cool features. It just plays music.
Yeah, it's this bricky thing. This was a first generation Zune.
I can't believe that still works.
That's the trick, is like every couple of years I have to change the battery, but that costs about $10 every couple of years, as opposed to like getting a SD card for my phone, which
would cost like $12.
It would cost way more. Like, this is a 30 gig fucking device that plays all my MP3s. 30 gig
brick. Like,
yeah.
It's actually, you can tell looking at it, the music's actually stored on like paper files.
Right. You put your CDs in the thing and then it remembers. That's how it works. But you know what? It's fucking cheap and it's never broke down or anything beyond like the battery life going to
just
shit.
Just hope that the girl that's working behind this gym counter is not listening to this, because she'll be like, son of a bitch, that thing's awesome.
Yeah,
you'll go to return the basketball and she'll just be like, that doesn't look like our basketball. You're like, it's got your name written on it.
But then she'd be that person who fucking stole a Zune. And the only thing more pathetic than somebody with a Zune in 2016 is somebody who would steal one.
Yeah.
Like, that's the thing. I don't even need a lock at the gym because I know nobody would fucking take it.
I think the like new character in Orange is the New Black is in jail for stealing a Zune. Like, I think that's the whole season arc.
That sounds right.
You'd get your ass kicked like every day if that's what they. What are you in for? Oh, I shivved a guy. Well, what are you in for? I stole a Zune.
I took a Zune. You don't understand, man. This thing could hold so many songs. All for the price of one entire pocket. So I'm waiting for her to give me back my fucking Zune. And I realized, like, all the keys in, like, my Zune are just in this little tub, like this pencil box. And it's just right on the counter. And I could have reached in and fucking grabbed my Zune. But I would jingle a bunch of keys and shit. I figured, like, that would probably look pretty bad if I was trying to break into the goddamn box, especially on, like, my first day there.
Excuse me, what time is shift change?
But it just, like, it made me more mad that, like, my brother is like, oh, I'll just put my wallet there. It's no big deal. It's like, dude, somebody could have just walked in and just grabbed that fucking box. And that woman would not have been able to do anything.
Well, they probably wouldn't care. They'd be like, eh. It's like we've talked about it with your job when somebody steals. It's like when you're the person in that position, right? You're like, I'm not going to get shot because of. It's like,
I probably wouldn't take people's like valuables over a fucking basketball. Like, that's the annoying thing to me is like, I know you don't want to lose a basketball, but it's $20. If I lose my car keys, that's like fucking hours of my life. I have to go get a new fucking key.
And it's a pain in the ass to do. And some of those keys are expensive, but.
Yeah, it's like you could run down to the fucking sporting goods store and get another basketball. They're pieces of shit anyway. So why the fuck how am I supposed to put something more valuable in that goddamn box? Yeah, you get a Zune, motherfucker, and it better be there when I get back.
See, when I had a Y membership, which I love to have now, but it's just so damn expensive. Like a regular gym's like, oh, come join for a special $8 a month, but then it'll go up to $15. And the Y's like, oh, yeah, you can join the Y. It's only $95 a month per person.
It was so fucking expensive.
Yeah. But RY would just, you'd have to do that, but it was you left your membership card at the desk. They assumed that you'd want that back because you're paying 90 fucking bucks a month. Like, it wouldn't be worth, like, stealing the basketball and be like, haha, I got a $95 basketball, but I can't get
back.
And
while we were talking about it, I just thought, like, why don't they have me, like, put my membership down?
That makes more sense. Because not only that, but if you stole the basketball and left your Zune there, I mean, that could have been somebody else's Zune that you grabbed out of the locker room. You're like, oh, yeah, here, take this. Right. But, like, if it's the membership card and somebody steals your damn basketball, at least you know who the hell stole your damn basketball because you have their ID.
But yeah, I thought it was insanely stupid. And the people there just, like, seemed really kind of unpleasant. Like the guy who signed us up, the manager, just didn't seem to have any sense of humor about anything.
Well, no, because most of those people...
And it's
people,
like, I think you would be in good spirits that you're turning a $100 purchase into a $200 one with all your fees and shit. You think you would be a little happier.
No.
And he was unpleasant, and the woman was kind of like, I guess she didn't like my thing. I'm like, don't give him your fucking wallet. It's not worth it. Like, I don't care because I'm not going to talk to them at all beyond like, hey, can I buy a fucking Gatorade or something? And I'll say it like that. Yeah. Just swear all the time. It'll get you far in life.
It does endear you to people.
People find you a lot more pleasant if you just show no respect or politeness. But yeah, she just seemed kind of like short-tempered and just like really like, ugh, these kids, they shouldn't be here. I was picking up vibes. All right. I'm a great vibe picker-upper.
See, that's my problem with gyms in general is like the Y for us would be ideal in that like everybody goes there. So there's not like the judgment, but any of the other gyms are much cheaper, but it's like you walk in there if you're not already like roided out, if they can tell that your life's not about how much you can lift, then it's just like, what the fuck are you doing here? It's like, well,
yeah,
there's various stages of fitness. Like, I don't need to be whatever the hell you are, but
yeah. And that's my thing, is just it's less to do with appearance or like trying to achieve some physical goal. It's just I am a lot happier if I'm like regularly being active, and basketball's an easy way for me to have fun but also move.
Unless it's NBA 2K whatever that you're playing, then
that's not basketball, that's fucking horse shit.
There was like a very small period where you got into that game, and then it seemed like you didn't like it at first, and then it's like, oh yeah, I'm getting into this, and then it seemed like you kind of were like, nah, never mind.
No, that's not really, because I played an entire season, and then the season ended about as bad as you could hope for.
You were the Warriors of your season.
Kind of, but we were the Eastern Conference, so we lost to the Bulls in the conference, or the Cavs in the conference finals.
Oh, I thought you got to the championship.
No, Kyrie Irving fucking lit me up,
and then it was kind of the same problem I had. A couple of years ago, I played one of the NHL ones. And I like to, if I'm going to do a simulation, I always do like the create a player mode, because that's, in my mind, that's like the coolest way. It turns it into like a sports RPG.
Yeah.
But with something like hockey, they, in fairness, they gave you like all sorts of options. But, you know, hockey, you have lines, and your line tends to only be out on the ice for like a minute or two, and then they switch up. And it gives you the option to, like, if your player's on the bench, to play as somebody else. But I'm like, that's not real. That takes away, then I'm not simulating myself. So I would always do the one where, like, when you're on the bench, you're basically fucking just watching hockey. But the downside to that is you end up losing a bunch of games that you had nothing to do with, because all the stuff would happen when you're just, like, watching your teammates fuck up. Mm-hmm. Which is like actual sports, but...
Right.
Unless you're the Indians, then you just always win.
Yeah, that's true. But yeah, it's... I enjoyed it.
Circle all the way back around. Sounds like you're still playing the crap out of Overwatch.
I did. I got a blue mouse.
Oh, man, you're getting serious.
There's like 8 fucking buttons on this thing. I only know what like 2 of them do.
See, I'm so damn clumsy. I've looked at those mice, like, especially when I played Warcraft, World of Warcraft, because it would be really convenient. You could have had a lot of your hotkeys on the mouse, but I'm like, I'd be just fucking hitting random buttons by accident.
Yeah. And, like, I haven't had that problem. I only got a new mouse because, like, my other one would just freak out in the middle of matches. The last thing you want when you're fighting a ninja is for your character to randomly go, like, ugh! You know, and that helpful. Would happen all the time.
Nine times out of ten, it screws you, but the one time that it's a ninja, they happen to jump there, you look like you're a genius. Like...
Yeah, and but now it's a pretty good mouse. It wasn't that expensive. It was like $40 or $50. I don't remember. And now that competitive mode has started. Now I'm properly equipped.
As opposed to the cooperative mode that you were playing before. No, they just introduced like actual ranked play, right?
Yeah, and they changed the structure of the matches a little bit, which I kind of like because it gives you kind of an incentive to keep playing like the more casual mode, because the ranked mode is like it's the same match mechanics, but there's like a point system attached to them. So in the regular game, it's kind of a all or nothing sort of thing where it's like whatever the objective is, the other team has to attack it and the other team has to defend it. And you know, like the attacking team has to get everything done or the defending team has to hold out the entire time. In this one, there's more of a point system. So there's like checkpoints in the matches and that will give your team a point. And like you do two rounds of like each team gets to do attack and defend once. And if you tie up, you do a sudden death round. And so it's really cool. Like, I like how it's a little different. It's stressful as fuck because not only is your rank going to go to shit, you're like other people's ranks are going to go to shit if you play badly, and they'll be mad at you specifically.
I did seem to be the one player that when I was doing ranked Heroes of the Storm, I take that back. Not usually, because I'd play kind of you never got into Heroes, so I'd usually play like the Valas and stuff so that you don't have the spotlight. I usually get overlooked, I guess, when our team did bad. But there are the times where your team does horribly, and it's really a team effort where everybody's doing horribly, and it's fun when you're the one that gets singled out. Like,
yeah well, that was, I'm working on part two of the Overwatch character review, and I actually have it written up. But that's kind of the experience I've had with Hanzo is, like, I've had the best matches of Overwatch with Hanzo. But I've also probably had my worst matches with him because he's so, like, you have to be so accurate with him. And if you're just off your game, you're going to fucking plummet. And the rest of your team will be pissed that you, like, as if they don't have guns of their own. They will be pissed that you didn't magically make all their enemies disappear and from a distance. And it was
the rest of your last team night, will be pissed.
One of the matches I lost. Like, as if I just did my placement matches. You have to do like 10 placement matches to get your starter rank. And I went 6-4. And one of the matches I lost, I had a really bad round with Hanzo. And then I was like, well, fuck it. Like people were giving me shit, chewing me out. I was like, well, fuck it. I'll be Lucio. I'll just do support. You guys take charge here. You fucking kill people. And I still had, like, second most eliminations. And, like, and that was only, like, 4 with Lucio. So this idea that, like, only one person ever cost you the game is complete bullshit.
Well, it's like we talked about last week. It's a lot of times it's simply like the players' individual play styles don't mesh, and they'll act like they'll be the one like alpha douche that acts like, oh, we're losing because you're all not playing to my play style. And it's like, well, if you'd be a little more flexible, then it wouldn't be an issue. But you really get screwed when you have players that can't adapt to like their teammates' abilities and styles. Because I've played when I got up to like rank 8. Like, it counts down in Heroes of the Storm, and I don't know what the highest rank is, but of course one would be like the elite Anything in like the top five, I think, or top three is like considered really, really good. And I never got that high, but I was up to like seven or eight. And the one thing I noticed is I'd play on some teams that were really bad, but we'd actually cooperate and work together and we'd win the game. And then you'd play on teams where the individual players were really good, but they couldn't fucking work together to save their life. And you'd lose to teams that you had no business losing to. And it's funny. I'm sure you see the same thing. The tension and the like vitriol and everything when you're playing a ranked match ratchets up like 1,000%. Because there's so much, everybody gets affected when you lose. It's like, well, there goes my ranking. And that's what I would get when I would play casual Rocket League. It would be like, oh, this is just fun. And, you know, you'd get frustrated sometimes, but you're like, oh, you know, it's just Rocket League. When I got into the ranked Rocket League, that's when I would be like ready to throw my monitor through my window because like other players sucking is like screwing up your rank.
Yeah. And I mean, like I get mad when we lose at Overwatch, and I get frustrated with my team, but I'm just not that guy who like get in chat and just start blaming people for shit, even if I think it's well deserved. Like,
yeah, well, that's a good point. Like I said, I'd be ready to like just smash everything in my living room, but I wasn't the guy in chat being like, "You fucking idiots, you should have done this or that." Because I'm, yeah, if I can get through a match without saying a single word to anybody else, that's great. Like.
Yeah, there's fucking so much hate, dude. How could you fucking cost me my goddamn experiences? Like, because it's a fucking video game. Like, if you are that concerned, then build your own team.
Exactly. That's what's always so funny. Like,
don't do fucking public matches then, because this is the fucking...
Well,
this
that's
is
the
why
reason
you
why those people don't have teams is because nobody can put up with them.
Yeah, because they're unbearable fucking... Right. Like, and that's the thing. Like, I kind of start... the next part of my Overwatch deal talking about like how I should have held off, because once you give people an arbitrary fucking number that they have to maintain, like you see the real bastard in them come out.
Right.
You know, once they think there's like something at stake when really there's not, it's like they just become the worst pieces of shit. And like I said, like I get frustrated and stuff, but I keep it to myself. Because nothing I say is going to make them a better player or, like, give me the win or something. So it's just, it's this weird, like, what do you hope to do besides, like, get reported for being an asshole? Like, when you go into chat and just, like, talk a bunch of shit.
Right. It's funny. And like I said, maybe the difference is just our filter, like, because I probably get that pissed off, but my reaction when I get that pissed off is like self-destruction, not like tear other people down.
Yeah, well, I mean, like in Overwatch, and especially competitive mode, is pretty great for that, where it will, like, you get kicked out of like the server once the match is done, and it sets up new teams and stuff.
Yeah,
and people
yeah.
want
Heroes is the same way. Like, after the match, there was like a brief like 2 seconds to vent whatever you were gonna say, and then it's gone. Unless you're just that guy that like PMs or you know, sends a direct message to the teammate to continue.
just starts stalking them.
That's when you have a problem. That's pretty pathetic when you do that.
My problem is when somebody's doing that in the middle of a match. Like, you know, because you do have that time afterwards to bitch and complain. But when somebody's whining in the middle of the game, that means they're not fucking
exactly.
working. And it's like, well, you're dragging the fucking team down. Like, I'm not worried about the guy who just got the game and is, you know, going to suck a little bit. I'm wondering what's going on with the rank 80 motherfucker who's had the game since it came out. And is just bitching in the corner.
Right. Well, like you said, if you were really any good, you'd have a team anyway. But, I'm like the most humble person in the world, and I wish people would recognize me as such. Like, I went to plaque and all. But the one thing that I was really good about when I would play competitive games, Heroes especially, because that one, more than Rocket League, I never would type messages in Rocket League anyway. I'd be the sarcastic, like, nice shot guy. but in Heroes, the one thing I was really good about, and if somebody was being a dick to me, I'd usually just sit and take it. And to be honest, at least like the majority of the time, if I was getting that, it was because I was having a bad game, and I'm like, what am I going to say? Like, I'm playing like shit. Yeah, I probably, well, nobody deserves that, but what are you going to say? Like, if you're actually playing bad, what are you going to say back to the person? But when I would really shine would be when it would be somebody being a dick to a teammate, because it's 5-on-5. I think that's what it is in Overwatch 2, right?
Yeah, well, no, 6-on-6.
Okay. Well, it's 5-on-5 on Heroes. And so when I would shine would be when somebody's being a dick to a teammate, and then I'd get fed up. Like, if you're going to lose anyway at that point, then I'd stop. And, like, I was so good at, like, saying just the right thing to – not that the person that's being a dick, it needs to be pointed out that they're being a dick. Everybody on the team knows that. But it was really good at saying the things that would just, like – completely, like, here's a billboard that you're being a dick, and that they would have nothing to say back to it to, like, defend themselves. And by the end of the match, like, the whole team would just be, like, laughing at everything I say, and one person would still be over.
And I was super cool, and I could sit at any lunch table I wanted.
Exactly. That's what was so great, to be like I said, I'm humble, and I needed to be lifted up on everybody's shoulders. But you would still have that one dick, like, trying to, like, sit over in his corner. Usually they'd end up just quitting the match, because that's when you know you've done really well, when it's like, even they're like, well, fuck, I'm beat, and they just leave. But but it's frustrating, because, like, I would play that off, and it'd be funny, but at the same time, it's like, thanks, you just wasted my time and all of our rank, because you're gonna sit over there and whine like a little piece of crap. That said, competitive games are so fucking, like, addicting to me, and I can't wait to... I'll be picking up Overwatch. I have considered to do it after the show, because it's like, well, I get paid in 24 hours, so I'm not paying any bills between now and then anyway. But,
Yeah, I mean, it's especially tricky when you have the goddamn Steam Summer Sale, which I've just kept buying shit off of, even though I play Overwatch every night.
I've been fairly good about that. There's been a few things that have been so close to buying. Basically, the first day of the sale, everything, but I've got, like, I'm not like some people with, like, a million things, but I've got, like, 37 or 38 games in my wish list, and out of those 37 or 38, like, 36 were on sale. And I'd be like, oh, sweet, so everything's on sale. And I'd, like, scroll through, and I'm like, I still don't really want this. I still don't really want this. And there was a couple I was going to get, and I didn't. I did pull the trigger on Vermintide and played it, and immediately I was like, shit.
I fucked up.
And it's not that it's a bad game, but it's... I was trying to satisfy, like, hold me over until... There's, like, two Warhammer-type games coming out next year that both look really cool. Deathwing and Inquisitor. And this is kind of that first-person shootery Warhammer-type game. And it's like, well, that'll hold me over till these come out. But it's really the best, and other people told me this when I had talked about the game, but the best way to describe Vermintide is it's Warhammer Left 4 Dead. You know, it's four-player co-op. You can play with bots, but I hear the bots are pretty shitty. Like, you really want to get with other players. And, like, the one mission I played was just us running through streets, like, slaughtering this never-ending tide of rats that would come at you. And it just wasn't very fun. Like, it's chaotic, but there was, like, at least the way I played, and maybe it's just because I played one mission, but there was, like, no real strategy or cooperativeness to it. It was just, like I'm playing as the Witch Hunter, which the Witch Hunter is the one class in Warhammer that has me, like, completely addicted to, like, the old, there's, you know, the two... Warhammer 40K, like the futuristic space Warhammer. But the Witch Hunter is the older one, and it's just that, like, Bloodborne style character where the Witch Hunter's a monster slayer that uses rapiers and swords, but also can, like, switch over at any time to, like, dual wield pistols. And that's, to me, I just love that type of character. It's just so fucking cool. Be like, slash, slash, shoot, shoot, blood everywhere, woohoo. and so it gets that down, but it's just, there was, like, nothing really compelling about it. It was just like, slay everything with my rapier. Oh, here's a big thing. I'm going to pull out my pistols and like unload dual volleys at it until it's dead. I don't know. Even as I say it, it makes it sound cool. Like, wait, I can't wait to get back into that. But it's just, it wasn't that fun. So anyway, my point there is Steam Summer Sale, that was like $15. It was on sale from 30, and I'm like, oh, 50%, I'll pull the trigger. And I'm like, eh, yeah. I probably could have got a couple, some better things for $15 than that.
Yeah, I picked up South Park and the Stick of Truth.
That's a good game.
I liked it. I started up. I play a little bit. Just play like a few minutes every day. But I like kind of how there's a little bit of Paper Mario in there in terms of like the combat and stuff. And it's funny. You know, it's
from the RPG, like the combat standpoint, it's that type of game, but it's smart. It's done very well.
Yeah, it's a very simple type of game in terms of gameplay, but it's, you know, it doesn't try to be anything more than that. Like, it's just a solidly executed South Park game.
And it does, and especially more at first, it feels like, oh, this is the kind of, like, you can't lose combat system. But it gets a little more complex, but it's all nothing. I don't want to say complex, that's the wrong word. It gets a little more involved where you have to, like, at least kind of think about what you're doing. But it doesn't turn into, like, Final Fantasy with all the different, like, potions and like, status effects and that kind of thing.
And maybe a little more so than Paper Mario. Like, how you time your attacks and stuff seems way more important.
Yeah.
But
it keeps it fun, though. Like, it's not, like, mindless.
Yeah. Like, I love Paper Mario, and I hope one day Nintendo will actually go back to it. but, like, if you don't time your blocks in Stick of Truth, like, you can get fucking killed just by a normal fight.
Right.
At least at the beginning. So I picked that up. I've been playing it, enjoying it. I picked up Audio Surf 2, which is... It was like $5.
Yeah.
And
that's kind of one of those, like, it's hard to talk about game, but you can't go wrong with it. Like, it's
just a simple little shut off your brain a bit and, like, grab a couple songs off your computer and just play this weird rhythm game to it. I played some of the songs that me and my friend have made over the years, and it was fucking hard.
See, now you got to stream yourself playing the Njoystic theme.
Oh, yeah. That would be a... I don't even know if I have that on this computer.
See, if you did that, we could record it, and that could be the new intro to our show, Audio Surf and Joystick Theme.
Just me missing all the notes. So I picked that up. I, you know, play that here and there. I picked up Tomb Raider.
The first, not the new one.
Like not Rise of the Tomb Raider, the one before that, because that was like $5, I think.
That's a... I really liked that game. I shouldn't have. The individual parts all pissed me off, but somehow the overall impression was still really positive.
It was free on some website for a while, and I didn't jump on it. Or it was like $1, I think. And I just didn't want to make a membership to like another site for a game. I don't know when I was going to play. But now I ended up spending $5, so I look like an asshole. And I picked up Bioshock 2, and I wasn't going to do that because like I looked at Bioshock 2, and it was like $4. And the only reason I would care about Bioshock 2 is like there was the Minerva's Den DLC, which was like its own side story that was apparently way better than Bioshock 2 was.
Right.
And I looked at that, and it was $9.99 for like, which it wasn't on sale for like the first 2 days. And then, like, I checked it again, and it was, like, down to, like, $1. Or, like, I think $2, maybe. And I was like, well, fuck, gotta get that. But now I'm trying to, like, draw the line. Like, I'm not... No more fucking shit.
Yeah.
Because I don't...
I keep looking at it every day.
Once you buy it, you're out of money.
Well, yeah, that too. I keep looking at it every day and not finding... I was kind of, like, this close to the $10 for Skyrim. But I've seen it cheaper, like, not in a big sale.
Also, well, I don't. It might be a while before it's cheaper again because
of the. But it could be a while. But it's the kind of game that's like, well, if so be it, then like I don't need to play it.
So like, my thing is, I have Morrowind, and if I feel like going back to an Elder Scrolls game, that'll probably be the one. Yeah. Even though the combat's way worse.
Everything's way worse. Well, I can't say everything.
Everything's way worse, but people like it's. It's one of the. I think it's one of the best modded games by the community.
And you have that like nostalgic attachment to it too. I've never played Morrowind, so.
Oh, it's fucking great, provided you take into account it's from like 2000.
I have such a hard time going back. Even like games that I loved back then, Deus Ex, I downloaded that when it, or downloaded, bought it when it was on like one of the, I think even regularly it's cheap, but I think I got it for like a dollar.
Yeah, I think that's, my brother picked it up on the sale and that was what it was, I think.
Yeah. And I was like, sweet, I can go back. And I like played it for like one night and I'm like, nope, this is too cumbersome and like old.
That was like System Shock 2 for me.
Right. Or I've talked about Silent Hill. I'd love to be able to play Silent Hill, but those games do not age well from, not the graphics I can overlook because that, whatever. But it's like the whole control and menu system and user experience in general is just, like at the time it was fine because it's what we were used to. And now you're like, ugh.
Yeah. Yeah, it's rough. It was a rough learning curve for a lot of games, a lot of types of games, anyway. Except for Doom. Doom had it right from the get-go.
That's what... I finished it, the single-player campaign. I had to cheat. Like, everybody's like, oh, you got to play it on hard. I'm like, halfway through, I'm like, fuck this. I'm putting it on the easiest setting.
I didn't play on hard. I played on the...
I was nice on like the default. Yeah, I was on the default setting till about halfway, and I could have probably finished, but I was getting tired. The Doom is really built around like that old school. You explore a little bit, then you walk into a big room. It's like a big arena, basically, and there's waves and waves of enemies. And of course, as you get further in the game, not only do the enemies themselves get tougher, but the waves get longer. You'll have like more things teleported, and I just got tired of having to like retry fights where I'd spend like 10 minutes in the fight and be to like the last wave and then die from something stupid, and it's like, ah.
Yeah. I think that middle of the road difficulty is a good first playthrough speed. Trying to do it all on hard.
Yeah, that. But at this, I get their point, because one of the many, many, many things that makes Doom such an amazing game is that from just like shallowly looking at it, you'd think, oh, this is just a hectic run around and they throw things at you and everything's crazy. But there is a lot of strategy when facing these waves.
Yeah, like, and I talked about that in the review, just like how these like hectic, fun battles are also these really... like intense resource management sort of situations of just like, okay, I'm out of weapons for all these guns. I still have these two guns, but I might need that shotgun. So should I chainsaw this guy or should I save that for something else?
And then by the end, you add in, it's like, I've got this chainsaw, but it's limited. I've got the BFG, but it's really limited, but it.
Yeah. And you have to decide that, like, as you're about to stomp something's head, like you have to make all these choices in a split
second. And what
makes
it even more difficult is there's never a tell when you're close to the end of the wave. So I was terrible at, even when you put it on easy, like towards the end, I was like getting that, like, oh, now this is just getting repetitive, because it takes a lot of that away. It's way more forgiving. And that's where I'd have been screwed, because a lot of the fights I would hold on to my chainsaw and I'd hold on to the BFG ammo, be like, okay, you know, I don't want to use this too soon. Then all of a sudden, next thing you know, you've killed everything and you're like, well, fuck, like, I survived, but now I'm out of ammo and I don't have a big demon to saw in half and like get my ammo back. But on easy, it was pretty forgiving. Like, that never caused like a horrible problem for me. On medium, or especially on the hard settings, that would screw you. Like, you could theoretically win a fight and still fuck yourself over, because now you don't have ammo for the next fight.
I never really had that problem, though.
They do a good job of, and that's when you can tell a big fight's coming up. A lot of times you come across a room and it's like, here's all the ammo and armor you could want. You're like, oh, crap.
Yeah, I don't think there was ever a time I went into a fight and thought like, oh, shit, I have nothing. There were times where it's like, I really wish I had ammo for that gun. But for the most part, like, they give you so many guns and they give you so many opportunities to refill them that it's like, okay, well, this is the time where I have to make this weird gun kind of work for me.
It was weird to me how end-loaded the boss fights were, but it worked, because what it really did is, just as I was starting to get bored of the, like, wave the enemy, rinse, repeat, get to objective formula, then they threw the bosses in. Like, I think if they would have thrown boss fights in, like, evenly paced...
Every other level or something.
Yeah, then it would have all got stale by the end. But this way, it was like, just as it was getting stale, they're like, oh, yeah, fucker? Well, here's the cyber demon.
Yeah. And I actually... The more you've talked about it, the more I like that decision. Like, I didn't have a problem with it. But now I realize, like, how smart it was.
And the boss fights were awesome. Like, I loved every one of the boss fights.
And yeah, like, the one who would, like... I don't remember his name, but, like, the demon who would, like, shoot up the walls and, like, basically put you in a hallway and you had to dodge, like, his, like, energy beams or whatever.
Yeah, that's the cyber demon.
That's the cyber demon? Okay. Like, I really fucking like that fight.
Mm-hmm. And it was funny because it was, all the fights were fair. They were, and that one in particular, I liked that one. I liked the one where the second phase they split into, like, two big demons.
I hated that break.
Oh man, it made it so fucking
hectic. It
gave
me so much trouble.
Yeah, and then the final one I liked because that's a classic boss fight. But I don't know how I would have got through it not on easy, because there were certain phases that I just did not see what I was supposed to do to avoid getting hurt. Like, it started off pretty easy, and then I was like, okay, now I don't know how to dodge this. Like,
yeah, that I like that boss fight. And it, like, on an individual attack basis, I know how to avoid a lot of that stuff, but it also felt more like a race than like a proper boss fight, where it was like, well, just hit it with everything you got of the BFG. Hopefully you saved it up. And then, you know, you take her out before she like goes really crazy and just starts throwing all of her attacks at you at once. Yeah, that fight gave me a lot of problems too, but I don't think like normal notches it up any harder than all that, or much harder.
I think you take less damage, and I think your guns do a little bit more damage. I don't know, in the final boss fight, I don't think they do, but it's hard to imagine that they do any less damage, because anything other than like the rocket launcher, the railgun, and the BFG, it was like, oh, shotgun, you. I had to, like, look super close. Like, did that actually take health off? You're like, oh, it did.
Yeah.
And that fight was interesting because it was literally, hope you have all your ammo. Well, they made sure you had all your ammo. And it's like, this fight's going to take every last bullet you have. But I liked that. And what I really liked about the game, and this will be spoilery, so if you're listening and you don't want story spoilers, don't listen. But most of you are already not listening, so good job. I loved how they tied that into the earlier Doom games. Like, it's not a proper sequel, but they don't ignore the fact that Doom's
a
thing.
And Doom Guy is a thing.
And then they turned the whole, instead of like directly referencing any event whatsoever, they turned Doom Guy into this like legendary Hell Slayer that all of Hell is afraid of, and that they've trapped for God knows how long, but obviously, considering nothing else references,
and that's like a story that does justice to like how people felt when they first played Doom,
like, and it kind of fills in the backlog of after Doom with this like idea, like, because you know your character in the older Doom games, he, instead of going back, he stays in Hell and he's slaying all these demons. Like, he basically gives up his soul. He knows that he'll be in Hell for eternity, but he wants to kill every last demon. And then you find out that that's basically what he was fucking doing. Like, Hell was just like, well, shit, we're screwed, until they managed to trap him, and then it was like, okay, everybody in Hell, all you demons,
do not let him fucking out.
Yeah, just stay the fuck away from this crypt. So when you wake up, you have no idea who you are, but you just, you know, you're driven to kill these things. And then you start to learn this, and you're like, yeah, I'm this badass that they keep talking about. Like, all of Hell is afraid of me. And it almost paints this demons in this, like, oh, shit light, instead of like, oh, yeah, we're demons and we're bad, which they are. But it's also like, oh, shit, we're demons and we're badass and we want to, like, kill everything. But fuck, this guy's awake.
Fuck, it's him.
Right. And it was such a great...
Shit, dude, run, it's Doom Guy.
It was just an amazing way to connect it all so it's still one universe, but not have to address any one event in particular.
Yeah.
And
you just need, like, for a Doom game to work, you just need certain elements. And you don't have to, like, tell... You know, like, it doesn't have to be all one, like, consistent story. Really, like, you can have these sort of grand jumps in time as long as when you start your game, you give players that sort of familiarity.
And it made sense. It's like, oh, okay, well, mortal life on Earth is cyclical. Like, these people that are, you know, harnessing the energy now have no idea that this has taken place. Well, they do now because they're starting to find these and piece together, like the android slash whatever that releases you knows about the lore, but just based on what they found in hell. It's not like, oh yeah, we know the history books of what happened before. So it's all like the same universe, but it makes sense that hell itself would be eternal. Like, for them, it's just all one long timeline. For the people of Earth or Mars, they're just discovering this. And I don't know, I just loved that. Like, not that the game has the most complex, deep story. It doesn't need it. That's not the kind of game Doom is. But for them to be able to just not only, like, have the game feel like old Doom, but tie it in such a way, like, the more I found of the lore, like, my smile would just go from ear to ear as I'd listen to these things. I'm like, that's so fucking cool.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah. It's a wonderful game. The only criticism I have is that I bought it with a coupon for $45, and then those assholes put it on sale for $35, like, 3 days later on Steam.
But yeah.
To be honest, the game's so good, I don't care that I spent more on it, because I'm just glad I picked it up. But that's my luck.
Yeah, I've done that so many times that I'm just sort of, like, numb to it now. Like, yeah. Of course, that thing's only $5 now. Why wouldn't it be?
I wasn't actually mad, but it was just like, of course.
All right.
But, like, because it's worth 40, it's worth the full 60, but it's just, it's on sale so many places, you're an idiot if you pay 60 for it. But
yeah, it is an outstanding goddamn game.
On the flip side, I've been playing a lot of the multiplayer because I'm kind of in that period right now where I'm like, I don't have a game that I'm, like, dying to play. And the multiplayer is a good one to put on, just like, ah, fuck it, I'll just play some multiplayer. I suck at the multiplayer. And it's hard because for the PC at least, there is a lot of cheating and hacking going on because they have very few systems in place to fight it, and that's frustrating. But it's also really hard sometimes to tell for sure, like, is this person good or are they cheating? There's been one person that I bothered to report through Steam because it was obvious, like, they didn't do anything to mask the fact that they were...
Because he absorbed my computer over the web.
And then there's been, like, every other match I've played, there's always been that one person where you're, like, fingers hovering over the, like, report button. You're like, but I just don't know for sure. And if I don't know for sure, I'm not going to do it. But
that's one thing in Overwatch. Like, I haven't seen really any cheaters, but, like, I just don't have the energy to report people. Even though it's, like, a few clicks, I'm just sort of like, yeah, even though this guy's a fucking dick, like, yeah, like, I don't want anyone to say, like, because I know I can be an asshole. So it's like, well, I'll have thicker skin. And
yeah. Well, and it takes a lot to get me to report somebody for things that they say. Cheating, you know, like using a hack, you're not going to have that.
Cheating, yeah, you got to jump on that.
And you won't have that as much. I can't say you'll never see that in Overwatch, but Blizzard knows what they are. I mean, that is a competitive game that they're going to build. Like we will see Overwatch on TV at some point, like they do Heroes of the Storm or Heroes of the Dorm. So it's very important to Blizzard to stay on top of that.
Right.
Bethesda doesn't seem to have that same case. They're just like, eh. I mean, that's literally been their response. There's been complaints on the forums, like, because there's no, they don't have the Steam, the VAT protection that Steam uses. They don't really have their own.
And it's when almost they're like multiplayer is tacked on.
That's the thing shit. Is anytime they've been questioned about it, their response that I've seen so far has just been like, meh. Yeah. And that's frustrating because it does detract from the fun of the game. But I don't, like I said, when it's to the point where there's only been one or two times where I know it's hacking and the other time I think it's just people that are good. And it makes it harder to tell when I suck so bad. The best I've ever done is like on a 6-on-6, I was the 5th overall. So 5 out of 12, just barely above 50%. It's the highest. Like, we've talked about Counter-Strike I used to play, and I'd usually be number 1 or 2 on my team because I'm humble. I don't want to brag, but there was a point I was very good at Counter-Strike. Even when I played Call of Duty on 360, I was typically, you know, middle of the road was a bad game for me. I was typically towards the top, not usually the best in something like that because you have such devoted people. Mm-hmm. But I can hold my own. I'm competent. And Doom, I am usually in last place on my team or second to last place. Like, yeah.
So but I keep playing. They're all cheating, is what you're saying.
That's right? What I think is happening, is every single person is cheating but me. Again, I'm humble, but there's no possible way I could be so bad unless everybody else is cheating.
Right. I agree. It's impossible. So the other thing I ended up playing, finishing up, was Ratchet and Clank.
Ah, yes.
And really like that game. In some ways, it seems a little more shallow than the games I've played before it. Kind of like, well, shit, we have to make a Ratchet and Clank game to go along with the movie. There are times where you kind of get that vibe from it. But it looks good, and it plays great. And except for one weird, like, out of nowhere, like, stealth section near the end of the game, like just before the final boss, there's this section where you have to keep transforming yourself into Captain Quark. And anytime you jump or attack, your disguise goes away. And so you have to do your actions when like these robots aren't looking at you. And if they see you, despite you having all these weapons, they hit like a magic red button that instantly kills you.
Fun.
It is such a fucking horrible idea. Especially, and maybe this is asking a lot for Ratchet and Clank, but I'm just thinking, like, my mind went to, like, wasn't Metal Gear Solid great? How it let you handle situations however you wanted? You know, like, when you're equipped from ear to ear with fucking this just arsenal of explosions, like, why the hell am I hiding?
Because
the game has some fucking arbitrary thing that'll kill you in one hit.
I've complained about it a lot. I hate when games, and adventure games, like, all seem to do that. It's like, we need a stealth level. It's like, if you're not a stealth game, no, you fucking don't.
Yeah.
But it makes it extra bad when they throw it in, like, in the last, like, if it's in one of the last, like, three levels, then it just feels like, oh, we've run out of ideas. Here you go.
Yeah. And it's not fun, and it's never been fun when it's just been this annoying, like people will ask me sometimes where it's like, well, why is it arbitrary that the thing kills you in one hit? Because if they have a thing that can kill Ratchet in one hit, why wouldn't the bad guys just use that? Like,
no, you wait till he's almost beat you, and you're like, well, fine.
We'll do it in this very specific scenario. And it just seemed really like this, like they didn't really have like a final level in mind. So it just seemed really lazy. Like, to me, a Ratchet, like in Going Commando, which was the second one, the last level was full of all these like you had to use all these abilities you gained throughout the game, where it's like you needed like your magnet boots to go up buildings, and you're riding the rails and stuff and shooting stuff from the rails, and of course this would all be broken up with gunfights and platforming. And like, for this to be the last level of this new one, I'm just like, you guys didn't fully want to make this, did you? Like, it's still good, but you feel like the half-heartedness to it. Like, it just struck me, and it's probably reading too much into a design choice I don't like, but it really just seemed to me like they were kind of burnt out on Ratchet and Clank. And like I said, they needed one to go with the movie.
See, I kind of got the impression that, well, probably not, because of how long it takes to make an animated movie, but I kind of thought they started working on the game first, and then we're like,
I think they were doing it kind of in conjunction.
Junction. What's your stealth level?
There's a bad one on a space station with a fat idiot.
See, now I'm thinking of Prey. No, not Prey. Crysis 3, I think, or 2. Whatever the fuck Crysis I played. I only played one of them. And it was a okay game. It was kind of cool. I liked the stealth suit and the tech bow that you could take people down with and whatever. But it was like a Halo-esque shooter. And then all of a sudden you get to the second to last level. And it's like, here's a driving level. It's like, what the fuck is that? And it was the most cumbersome, crappy, not fun driving that they could. Because you spend all this time, you spend years designing the first-person shooter experience, and then you make one level that needs driving mechanics. Of course it's not going to get the attention that all the other mechanics get. It's like, well, then don't do it.
Right. I agree.
Or the Sand Temple in Ocarina of Time.
I like that one. It's a good one.
I need to play. I really need to get that for 3DS and try to go through it again.
But it's that section is not stealth in that Zelda is pretty fucking lame. Like, it's dumb, but it's not hard.
No, once you understand I always use that as my excuse. I think it was more that back at that time I was in college and I didn't play that much games, so I probably just kind of wandered off of it, but it just happened to be at that point. But
yeah. Well, that is a kind of, that is probably the most, patience-trying point of that game is, when you have to find the fucking carpenter's sons and the fucking assholes just lock you in jail, and it's just tedious. But, once you realize that they can't see certain things, it was a lot easier, but.
But it's a Nintendo game, so even though it's been on 3DS for 8 years now, it will never go on sale.
No, never. Where I work, they're changing some stuff around, and one of the things they're getting rid of is renting video games. And we had actually some 3DS rentals as well. And so all those games are go on sale. And the messed up thing is whether it's brand new or old, really old, it's for these rentals, it's $49.99, just across the board.
Huh.
And it's dude, nobody's buying fucking Marvel Ultimate Alliance for $49. Are you insane?
Yeah, you can get it for if you look at GameStop and it's $4 there, why would I spend $50 for it?
Yeah, I have no idea why that is the way it is, but it was crazy. So
that's what happens when out of touch people have anything to do with video games.
Yeah, that's
why they need geniuses like us.
That's why capitalism is the best way for any country to go, because such smart, informed people. Why wouldn't you want them to handle healthcare?
Well, that's how much we paid for it. It's 13 years ago.
So, yeah, exactly. You paid for that year head start, that's whatever. It's getting hot in here. I'm getting angry, and you can tell because I'm getting political.
So, my dog's going fucking nuts right next to me. It's hilarious.
Oh, well, maybe we should just film her for 2 hours. And yeah. That'll be our show from now on.
She just leapt across the room onto her toy. I don't know what she's doing.
She's planning her escape.
Yeah, I'm talking about you.
Filling the room out. But anyway, I don't think there was really any news I noticed this week. I think everybody's kind of recovering from
last week,
getting back from E3 and shit, and just sort of slowing things back down.
All the important.
I saw Ford took art from Firewatch, and I found that fucking hilarious.
Yeah, like it's.
You didn't even change the colors, you fucking lazy assholes.
No, and it was a. I mean, it's technically Ford. You can say Ford did it. It was a Ford dealership, but like a Ford owned. Sounds like one of their like mega dealerships, like most places have. And right. It was funny because I know probably multiple people, but the first one that I know that actually like tried to follow up on the story was Michael Futter from Game Informer. He actually called and like talked to their advertising department. And the guy at first was just like, oh, yeah, well, you know, they pull all their assets from this website. That's, you know, it only here's the link. It only like gives assets that are, you know, free to use or something. But all the link really was a website that lets you check, like, to see if it is allowed to be used. To see if
something, yeah.
Right. And then when he asked him, like, is this your guy's normal vetting process, the guy just hung up on him. It's like, huh.
Yeah, it may. That is kind of a fucked up thing, I think, of the internet age. Is like, I would have never suspected, like, how little people want to credit other people's work.
Well, there's just this weird idea that if it's art and it's online, then
it's okay. Free.
Yeah, well, it didn't cost you anything to make it. So, well, yeah, I mean, it did. Time and talent. I mean,
time and talent. Yeah. If it didn't cost anything, then you fucking make it.
Exactly. You know? That's what, you know. That was the first thing I said, because there's been people that you directly like. They're like, oh, well, it's just a drawing. It's like, well, then you draw. It's like, well, I can't draw. Yeah. It's like, no shit. Yeah. That's the point. And when I say time, that's part of it. I mean, not only is there the physical time it takes to make that specific art piece, but there's the literally thousands of hours it took somebody to craft their art. You know, you're not nobody. I think a lot of us have this idea that artistic people are just magically artistic. Like, oh, I wish I could draw like that. It's like, well, that person couldn't draw like that when they were born.
Like what I realized and the reason I gave up on drawing, I was taking it pretty seriously when I was in like early high school. And what I realized was like, in order to get really good at this, you not only do you have to be kind of disciplined and hardworking, but you have to have a lot of patience.
Yeah.
Develop that.
Preaching to the choir. My first year out of high school, I went to an art school for animation. And same realization. It's like to get good. I mean, not everybody can. You do have to have some natural ability, but even the ones with natural ability spend, like I said, thousands of hours, their entire life getting better at that skill. But I think it's so easy for people to be like, well, it's just drawing. And what's funny is there's other things that people do that they make hundreds of thousands of dollars a year in salary for that literally anybody could do, but they happen to get into that position. But for art, for some reason, it's just art. I mean, it applies to photography, it applies to animation, it applies to a lot of stuff, music. But it's just funny to me that people have this idea, well, if it's a picture and it's online, I went to Google image search. It's like, well, great, but that's somebody else's
art. It's one thing, yeah, if you want to make it your personal wallpaper, it's a fucking other thing to use it for your advertisements. For commercial use, then you owe that fucking artist money.
Right. It's like, why didn't you go to a design firm and have them make some? Well, that would have cost us. It's like, exactly.
It costs, art fucking costs.
But it was just hilarious to me that the guy, just hung up.
And
I get it. I don't want to overly demonize. I mean, I do because it's wrong to do it. But I don't want to act like they're the only people that have ever done this and that Ford's terrible. I think,
like I said, it's a huge thing that happens all the time.
And I just think the average person doesn't understand why that's such a bad thing. But, I mean, it would be no different to put it in a car dealership perspective. It'd be no different than a salesperson spending a week, 6 hours a day for 5 days in a row working with a client, finding the perfect car and talking them into buying it, and then having another salesperson happen to be there and close on it and take all the commission. Like, wouldn't you be pissed on that? Like, the art thing is no different, but for whatever reason, we view it differently.
Yeah.
But yeah,
and that's coming from somebody who fucking hated Firewatch.
Well, yeah, I mean, they're two different things altogether. And I said that, I have no problem supporting Campo Santo and boycotting Ford, but that's because I don't like Ford to begin with.
That's an easy boycott. Ford, right. I'm not going to fucking buy a Ford anytime soon anyway. Right.
If I decline to buy a Focus, it's not actually going to be because they used Firewatch assets. It's because I don't like Ford. But
I mean, like, it's what I was saying is, like, you know, I don't like Firewatch, but it has such a distinct look and tone that it's like you can tell that these people just don't have any process to vet it, because, like, the first person with any sort of knowledge would be like, that's from fucking Firewatch.
Well, I think part of that also comes from, it's like, oh, it's a video game. How many people actually play games? It's like, well, hundreds of thousands. But it
turns out too goddamn many.
All right. But and I think it's part of it's that art style. There's an artist I follow, and I can't think of his name off the top of my head, but he has that, like, real, he does 3D stuff, but it looks 2D and painted, but it's that real, like, polygonal, kind of like how Polygon's, like, portraits, if you follow any of the Polygon writers, look. But that's, like, his style, and his shit gets stolen for stuff like that all the damn time. Because it's a really cool and unique style, and these people see this stuff, and they're like, oh, cool. That looks really nice. I want to use that for my ad.
Shit, free art. I'm going to use that on my YouTube thumbnail.
It's on Google. The funniest, I've seen people get pissed off because art has watermarks on it. Like, they're like, I tried to use this in this, like, big logo prints over top of it. It's like, well, yeah, you didn't pay for it.
But yeah, the only thing I don't like about watermarks is I like to change up my wallpapers all the time.
Yeah,
I want the art to look good, but...
But you're not going to try to steal it for your advertisement, then bitch, because there's a watermark in the way.
No, I print it out, and I frame it, and I say I made that.
Right.
And I invite people over to look at it.
But that's how it works. If you find one on Google that's not watermarked or signed, you can have it printed on canvas, and then you sign it. Once you've signed it, it's your art. Maybe I didn't design the art, but I printed it and framed it, so it's my artwork.
Like, that's the thing. Like, now it's, like, artists have a lot of opportunities because of the internet, but, like, before the internet, it was a lot harder to rip shit off. Now you can just copy, paste, and then, like, put it up on your Facebook and, like, not give credit. And then people will say, like, oh, it's from this. And then if you're the artist and you try to, like, contact them and be like, hey, you can't take that. They'll just, like, it's kind of like what Ford did. They'll just shut down. And
when they act like you're the douche. And in fairness, like, I don't know, the guy could have... Yeah, I can picture those. I don't know about your news, but my local news does that, like, 10 TV on your side. And they get do that thing where they get really fucking obnoxious and, like, basically stalk whoever the bad guy is supposed to be. And, like, literally, like, they'll be coming out of, like, a porta potty and they'll all of a sudden ambush him with a mic, shoving it in their face. And they'll be like, oh, they weren't willing to talk. It's like, well, no shit. I wouldn't be willing to talk to you in that circumstances. So it could have been like that, but I don't want to say I know Mike. I've never met him, but I have talked to him before and I interacted with him over various things. I don't picture him being that way, but it could have been the guy, like, you get this random call. Hell, you could half think it's a prank because you weren't expecting the call. But by now, I still haven't seen a statement like, oh shit, we're sorry, I don't know how this got past our vetting process. Even if it's all bullshit, like, as far as I know, they're being very defiant about it. Like, yeah, fuck you, it was online, it's our advertisement. And it's like, okay. I don't know that, you know, Campo Santo will sue him over it or whatever. That's their business. And you have to prove that there was damages done to you anyway. And unfortunately, that's the one slimy defense that's used all the damn time. It's like, well, we got you exposure. It's like, okay.
No, you didn't, because you didn't cite it. You know, like, you just taking my art is not giving me exposure, you assholes.
But
like, if you said art by so and so, right. and like displayed it with any sort of prominency, then like, yeah, okay.
There's a reason, like, when you watch weird, like CSI Miami and they're sitting there at their desk talking about how, oh my gosh, the killer did this, and they take a sip of what's obviously a Coke can. There's a reason it's like blurred out or turned so you can't see the logo. Like, yeah. Exposure does not hold up in copyright court.
Yeah.
Because you kind of have to have permission to do that
first. And you know you won't do that for fucking Coke or Pepsi, because they'll fucking jump down your throat.
Right, but most of these places, they know that you're small and don't have the money to fight us, so they don't care, and that sucks. Yeah. But it's the reality of our court system.
Yeah, it's bullshit.
But no, it was interesting. Like, it's certainly not going to make our end of year, like, controversy of controversies award, but it...
Well, maybe. If that would be a good year.
Yeah,
if that was the most crazy thing that happened.
That's true.
But we have like another 6 months to go. So,
and there's other things. There was something last week, but I don't really even have the energy to bring it up because I don't care. And it's one of those types of ones that no matter what stance you take, you're going to have somebody calling you an asshole. Right.
So what you're saying sounds familiar, but if it is, yeah, I'm worried that I'll remember what it was and then we'll have to talk about it. So, I would say let's not.
Sail on by.
Yeah, because it is fucking hell in my room right now. I am ready to call it a show.
Yeah, we're pretty much out of time. We're out of stuff, so I'm cool with that. I'm
fucking pouring sweat. I'm going to die.
See, so, I'm the jerk that watching. Just leaves all my air conditioning and fans on, so the whole show, that woo that you've been hearing, that's me.
Ben's like all that shit's on, but I don't want it going into the mic, so my door's shut. Yeah.
So and Ben's so dying now, for the show, and I'm just like, fuck it at this point.
Yeah. Well, I mean, we'll be like Polish radio, so nobody, nobody really likes it.
Sadly, I'm terrible at watching chat, so if you've said something and I missed it, I apologize. But we did get about the best compliment we've ever gotten this week, so that gives me the resolve. I was ready to call it quits, but I'll be back next week.
I'm reaffirmed now.
Yes, yes.
You lovely people. Oh, go fuck yourselves.